Okay, so what we're going through is our mission. Again, I'm just going to redo this for the
camera. Go for it.
Okay, and by making science fun, the idea is we're trying to instill a love of science and a love of learning in general. And the idea that that we're trying to inspire kids to science, to the kids someday that you may be teaching might go on to land on Mars, you know, or might go on to cure kids, or might go on to solve global warming. A story I always like telling is we've almost hired an instructor that has taken our programs. We're not quite there yet because we're only about, this is our 10th year. We've been doing after-school programs for about, did you take Mad Science
in
before?
In Seattle.
Okay, but not our program in particular.
No.
But you've taken Mad Science, so you would be
in
the
Seattle.
First, actually, okay?
Uh-huh.
Anyway, so I'm still looking for the first instructor we hired that actually took one of our classes.
Right.
We're getting close. We actually talked to one before, and he's in college right now. There would be probably a freshman, sophomore in college, and we only look for juniors or seniors or graduate students. But I did have a grandfather come to me and tell me that last year that, you know, his other grandson is taking, or granddaughter's taking Mad Science, and he came and he said, hey, you know, because I have another grandson, he's in Florida right now, and he's a chemistry major, and he said he first liked science, because he never liked science until he took your course, Mad Science, and he loved it, and that's what took him through middle school and high school, and now he's a chemistry major at Florida, and I just was overwhelmed by that, and I said, that's exactly what we're trying to do, is inspire, you know, he might become, go to graduate school, become a scientist, and all because maybe we kind of initially sparked that interest in science. You know, so that's what we're trying to do in Mad Science. So I always put that first and foremost in our folder. What we're going to do is you can just kind of turn over your pages. Mm-hmm. We'll go through these one by one. The next thing is and I want you to read all this stuff on your own. I'm going to go through it, kind of gloss over it real quickly. Is our code of ethics. This is how we treat kids. Basically, our philosophy about treating kids goes to say that we have to treat children with the utmost respect, be very careful how we treat them, especially now in today's world. And then on the second page of that is our philosophy, which is somewhat kind of what we went through in the interview, and it basically talks about what instructors can expect of us, our people working for us, our mad scientists, and we have the right to expect of our instructors as well. Okay, so read through that. You'll find that in a lot of the manuals. It used to be on the first two pages of every manual. The next thing we talk about is there's a lot of documentation in here to read about classroom management. Why? Because it's our biggest issue all the time, okay? We do good science. The content we can put together, the experiments we can design, the classes, the timing, everything else, this experience with kids, it's a little harder to train, and that's why we look for it in our applicants and our instructors. And this talks a lot about it. And even though we look for that experience, these are real life examples and tips and advice on what to do in classrooms, how to manage kids appropriately. The first one is a document that we put together specifically here, things that we wanted to say, things that we found. And that's probably about four pages. The second one is a bigger one. It's kind of the standard Mad Science group, which is our parent organization's document about classroom management. It's got a lot of, you know, pretty standard things you'll see about classroom management. So definitely worth a read through.
We also have a video that we made on classroom management.
Yes.
If you're more of a visual learner, available
yes.
in our links.
Yeah. But that would be in addition to reading those documents.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah. Those are it's going to help you with all the things. Classroom management is one of the things you just have to do, kind of like science, to kind of get used to. You have to get used to kids, the little mechanisms that kids follow, the idea of putting something in front of a child, okay, and not having and knowing that they will not pay attention to you with that in front of them. So a simple rule with kids, and this comes with that experience again, you never put anything in front of a child until you tell them what you want them to do with it, okay? So you're going to always demonstrate something, okay, explain how it's going to be done, and then you're setting stuff in front of a child. Then they know what to do, because if you do that first, forget about it. The class is going to be chaos, and they're not going to get anything done because they're going to be looking at this, you know, and not paying attention to you. This is kids. I have trouble doing it, okay? And I'm, you know, I'm 50 years old, so it's just the way people work. Demonstrate, explain, then basically the kids are going to come up, get their stuff, and off you go. Everything's activity-based in Mad Science. We're going to go through, if we can get a kid out here at some point too, we'll go through an actual manual or cheat sheet as well. Okay, inquiry-based science education. This is how we teach science. We use what's called the inquiry-based instructional method. It's a basic a philosophy about teaching. It's, you're not lecturing like a teacher. When we hire teachers, teachers are great. They have the experience we're looking for, but we have to retrain them a little bit. Why? Because we don't want them teaching. We want them doing mad science. We want them doing inquiry-based instruction, which means they're not lecturing. They're not telling the kids how it works. They're not explaining it to the kids how it works. They're asking questions. And that's what inquiry-based instruction is all about, is we want the kids to ask the questions. We want them to keep asking questions. And you ask questions right back at them. Well, why do you ask that? Or why do you think it works that way? Or let's do an experiment to find out if that's right or not. The idea that we're getting those critical, this is all about critical thinking skills. And that's what we're getting, is trying to get the kids to think for themselves and then do the experiments, make the observations, and then through those, you'll see the light bulb go on and they'll figure out the answer to their own question or the questions that we're asking them. So you're doing very little lecturing in math science. It's all activities and demonstrations. We do introductory discussions and we do concluding, you know, wrap-up discussions. That's really about it. And then we're just saying, you know, directions about things. We're not telling them what's going on. They're figuring it out. Okay, and that's inquiry-based instruction to a T. They're figuring out as they're going on by doing it. Okay. So in this thing, there is a kind of a little primer on it, and there is some nice tips on it, inquiry-based instructional tips. How to speak in kind of inquiry-based instructional mode. It's just trying to turn everything into a question, basically. Mm-hmm. Okay. On the next page, there's just a whole bunch of these classroom management type of documents, instruction tips, just things working with class. You'll see things about different age levels, things you have to know when you teach science a little bit. If you're working with a grade, third, fourth, or fifth graders, they've had atomic theory, which means they know about atoms and molecules. They know how matter it works a little bit. As a kindergartner, second, first grader, you say atoms and molecules to them, they're going to go, huh? They don't know it. They haven't gotten it. So you just have to kind of know what level of science they're getting. If you ever have a question about that, we'll tell you exactly what they're getting at what age level. But yeah, this will help you a little bit. That's the main thing, is matter, how matter works is a lot of it. But you know, you can't talk about, you know, potential kinetic energy to get into a kindergarten. They're not going to know what you're talking about. You have to talk about push and pulls and things like that. Mm-hmm. So it's a lot of it's just language, okay? So just know you have to teach to the level that we're teaching at. Sometimes you're going to get a mixed class. You might have fifth graders and you might have kindergartners or first graders. In those cases, you always aim high. Why? Because if you aim low, the older kids are going to get bored. If you aim high, the younger kids are still going to have fun. They may not understand it, but they're still going to have fun doing it. And that's what it's all about. The main thing is always to have fun with the kids. All right, so there's kind of a primer. Or this thing's kind of working with kids. The warning behind that is classroom management guidelines. An important piece of this one is that box right there. We'll go through that in a minute as well. Those are our three rules. We say those in every program that we do, workshops, after-school programs, events, everything. And it's basically, it's the behavior guidelines that we're drawing around the kids. You know, no talking when I'm talking, or no talking when the mad scientist is talking. We'll go through these in a minute, actually. Anyway, so a lot of things in here as well, you know, be prepared, plan your lessons, what to do if, possible scenarios and situations and what to do about them. Mrs. Ropp's classroom management tips that actually, let's see where we're at here. Mine's a little different from yours. I'm right here. Mrs. Ropp was a teacher up at Plum Elementary that we knew. She's retired now, I'm pretty sure. She was a former Pinellas County Educator of the Year. We used to sit, when I started, I used to sit in her classroom and watch her teach. She was awesome. You know, she would be really good with the kids, especially when she started with the kids and they didn't know each other, about getting those rules in place and managing the kids. Her biggest advice to anyone, go tough early, okay? And that means be hard on your kids at the start. Get them in line so they respect you, okay? Then you can ease up and have a lot of fun with them because the respect is already there. If you go easy early, they're going to take advantage of you, know that they can do anything they want, be testing you all the time. Your class is going to turn into chaos. Have to know that when you teach a math science class, all those kids, they want to be there. They signed up for the program, which is good, but it also means they're very excited about what's going on. They're also going to be doing activities versus you're just going to be talking to them. A little bit more difficult to teach in some respects than a normal class. But there's a lot of little tricks to it as well. So her examples are really good, you know, very straightforward, very structured, go tough early. Okay, we also had what we can do with any new instructor, we do have teachers that we work with. We could put you in a classroom with a teacher, pay you our training wage, $8 an hour, just to observe teachers and see how they do it. It's better right at the start of the year, right after Christmas break, where the kids are a little bit wild and the teachers have to really use those management skills again. But we can pretty much do it any time. Activities to keep kids busy. I'm sorry, I'm kind of out of sequence than you a little bit. This one right here. These, we hardly ever need them, but if you want them, they're here. And with these, sometimes you get into a classroom, the kids are all there waiting for you, and you have to set up your kit. Sometimes kit setup can take, in some cases, maybe 15 minutes. Mm-hmm. Most cases, 5 to 10 minutes or so. So if those kids are looking for something to do, you can play little games with them while you're setting up. You can start them on. They can do themselves. You shout out a word, word games, things like that. So something that might, if you want to use, to kind of have in your arsenal, to keep kids occupied doing something while you're setting up, if they're getting a little rambunctious or a little bored or something. Mm-hmm. Rarely have to do it. I mean, you can just tell the kids, hey, you know, let's do this or something like that. But it's good to have if you need them, okay? Okay, we kind of went through that already. And what's this one? This one's more about characteristics of kids in certain age ranges again, kind of what we talked about earlier. Okay, so let's put those back. And then we get into this document. This used to be an old... it's called Sniffle. I'm not even sure what it stands for. It used to be an old newsletter that our parent organization sent down to us, and then we sent out to instructors. They didn't do it for very long, but I love this page, so I always keep it in our orientation manual. One, it does have the beginnings of that mad science alphabet, mm-hmm. so we can think of a name for ourselves and use it. Doesn't have to rhyme with your name. It can be anything. We had a Mr. Sparks, and we had a... Dr. J, you know, so they didn't rhyme with their names.
I'm Pterodactyl.
Pterodactyl. Mm-hmm. So I'm
Kelly Kinesis.
Jurassic Jeff, Atomic Tom. So there's a lot of things. You can make up anything you want. Just have fun with it, okay? And, the other thing that's on this document that I love, it talks about more science, more laughs, more fun. It talks about the build-up technique. Teachers, good teachers use the build-up technique in almost everything they do. And what it is you're doing always when you're doing a class, and we try to design most of our classes, not all our classes like this, you start off with something simple and you're constantly building on it. One, you're building anticipation in the kids, so they're expecting and they know and they're anticipating something, that's going to control them right there. They get more involved and more interested in the class. The other thing it does, you're starting off with a fundamental concept, you keep adding to it and building on it, and so it just keep reinforcing it. So when they walk out of that classroom, your goal is they can say just maybe one general thing, you know, like, gee, polymers are, you know, chains of molecules. And if they get that and they can excitedly say that to their parents go, wow, my son or daughter, they learned something today. They're really excited about something. A perfect example of this class, to me, probably our best example is our Playing with Polymers class. And it's great because first we define what a polymer is. And a polymer is a chain of molecules. And we bring up the kids and they connect together and we do human chains, okay? And we talk about atoms and molecules and how molecules can be chained together to form polymers versus unchained, or they're monomers or single molecules. So we define them. And then we talk about the properties of a polymer and how they're, since they're chains, they're kind of stretchy and they're flexible and they can bend. And so we give the kids big piles of stuff and it's their job to separate what they think a polymer is and what a polymer isn't based on the properties that they know a polymer has. So now we've defined polymers. Now we said, here's some of the properties of polymers. Okay, let's start making some polymers, okay? And so what we start doing is doing different polymer experiments. We make the magic muffin, which is a polymer. It gets really cool. It kind of puffs up and everything. And then we make, I think, some putty. And then we make some slime, our favorite polymer. And each thing you're making, if you can get out there and they can touch it, you can want the kids to touch it or to smell it or to look at it or come up close and really view it, have fun with it. And it's all building on each other. So now we're making polymers by we're mixing matter in chemical reactions, you know, liquids and solids and stuff. So the last polymer we make is our favorite polymer. It's mad science slime, you know, and we mix a solid a couple of liquids together, and they're going to stir it. And so we're stirring it, and we make it, and we're kind of, you know, doing this slime, you know, and the kids are leaning forward, you know, and you're going, do you guys want to touch the slime? It's really cool. And they're going, yeah. And then you kind of pull it back, and you go, well, do you guys want to make your own slime? And they go, yeah! You know, perfect example. You know, they are so into it by that time. They're just, yeah. You know? And so the take home is they're all going to spend that last 15 minutes in class making their own polymer slime. So when they walk out of that class, they're going, Mom, look at my polymer right here. You know, it's a chain of molecules, you know?
Yeah.
And it's like, whoa, you know? And I get parents, I was at a dinner party on Saturday night, and I had two parents. My kids love math science. They just love it, you know? Two kids at Perkins. So it's great. I love to hear that, you know, when the kids are loving it, the parents are loving it, the teachers are loving it, the principal loves it, everyone loves it, and they keep coming back for more. Build-up technique is something that you'll see we do. Always keep in the back of your mind, how can I keep kind of building anticipation as we teach? So it does talk about it in there. It's really good. The next one is a little bit more elaborate, more in-depth, the idea of name. So you're Kelly, so you can go with kinetic or krypton or kinematic or ketone or kinesis, or come up with anything you want. You know, it can be your middle name. It can be some complete new name. Okay? The scientific method, something that we go and talk about a lot, and we immerse the kids in the scientific method. There are two documents, pretty similar, just a little different views of the scientific method. That word hypothesis, something that you want to get ingrained in the kids, in their vocabulary, in their minds. Talk about it all the time. When they walk out of 6 weeks, we want them using that word, you know, or saying, you know, I've got a hypothesis on how that works. That's great. You know, my son's using the word hypothesis, you know. And it's great. It's what science is all about. It's making that guess and then doing the experiment, making the observations, and then doing it again, possibly. And the idea is that light bulb comes on. They're answering their own questions. They're answering their own hypothesis, okay? Or they're proving it, okay? So very important, that's what we're doing. We're immersing the kids in the scientific method. The mad science rules, this is kind of something we get back to in that box. When we manage kids, we're basically outlining some rules for them, and that's kind of the box that we're keeping the kids in. The first thing the kids are going to do is they're going to test the boundaries of that box, and they're going to see what they can get away with. That's where the go tough early comes in, okay? Enforce the rules. Let the kids know that you're not an easy one, okay? That you're gonna get after them a bit. And we have a whole series of exactly how to do that in your policy manual. This is your orientation guide, different, about how you progressively implement the rewards or punishments to manage the kids. Basically, you keep them in that box. And by doing that, you know, you single out one child. What I do, tend to do, is at first class, I single out one kid. He's not even being bad. I just say, yep, you know, you're not following the rules, okay? Here's what's going to happen. You're going to sit out, you know. All the other kids are going, oh, okay, you know. It works every time, okay? I think Tom's a big believer in that. Cut used to do that right at the start. He used to say, you, you know. Even what? Man, I didn't do anything.
And the other kids are going
like, yeah, and the other, yeah, but you're going to, you know. You know? And the other kids would go like, oh, okay, and they wouldn't do anything. Like, perfect, okay? It works. I grew up in a family of five kids. It worked with us. And my dad used to single out my older brother. He didn't do anything, you know. You know, it's like, got us in line right off the bat, you know. Even apologize to my older brother.
Maybe even bond you guys together,
yeah.
You know.
It's like, I don't want to go through that. Okay, but anyways, the mad science rules. First rule, there's different ways to do them, but they're all the same rules, and you do want to make sure you consistently do them every single class. What I do is the first three classes, I'll say the rules. After that, I'll ask what the rules are, and they'll recite them back to me. First rule, no talking when I'm talking. You can't have the kids talking when you're trying to talk. Mm-hmm. I also add no talking when anybody else is talking. Mm-hmm. That is, we don't talk over each other here. If someone has a question, they're going to raise, or wants to say something, they're going to raise their hand, okay? And they're going to be, kids that aren't behaving are going to be picked on. Kids that are shouting things out are not going to be picked on for anything. So it's all about respect and about talking. Second rule is our safety rule, very important. No coming up to touch my stuff, okay? Or no coming up to the danger zone. Everyone has their different way of saying this. The idea is my stuff is up here, you don't come up and touch it at all. Why? Because sometimes we work with dangerous things. This stuff, not dangerous at all. But
they don't know that.
Our program up north is working with Tesla coils.
Dry ice yesterday.
Dry ice, electrostatic generators. Tom's working with that methane, or the methane bottle. Mm-hmm. All can be very dangerous. The idea is the kids don't touch any of our stuff. Do not come up to the danger zone. Unless they are called upon to be a volunteer and assistant. How are they going to do that? raise their hand again, okay? We're going to pick on the best behaved kids to be volunteers and assistants. Always try to help put rewards in there. We do the same. We try to live by what we preach. We try to reward good behavior before we punish bad behavior all the time. The third rule is always have fun. The last rule, there's a fourth rule in here that's number three in here. It's probably during events. You probably heard Tom do it. A lot of kids see a lot of our programs all the time. If you've seen it before, don't ruin it for anybody else. Typically, in your after-school programs, you can just stick to the main three. If you start doing events or you're doing something you think the kids have seen before, put that third rule in there because kids always want to give it away, you know, if they've seen it before. Egbert is the classic one, okay? And light a fire! Didn't I tell you about the third rule?
Yeah. I like to do the consequences the first day, too, and you mentioned some of them. Consequence of raising your hand is I'm going to choose you to be a volunteer. Yeah. Consequence of talking out, I'm going to give you a warning first. Yeah. If you continue to break that rule, you're going to sit out over there and point to the location. And then third, you know, and you can rejoin the group after one activity. If you keep breaking that rule, you're going to sit out of more activities, and I might need to speak to your parents at Carline.
Now, I do the same thing as Sarah does, except I don't talk it. I'll do it.
Yeah.
Okay, I will do it right off the bat so they see it. When they see it, they know it. Okay.
So you
there's
pair.
Good consequences and negative consequences.
Yeah. You say these consequences when you are giving the rules.
I do. I do the first day.
Yeah.
I say, you know, first you'll get a warning, then you're going to sit out of one activity. You may sit out of more activities, and I have your parents' phone numbers. I will call them.
Remember I said about teachers?
And I'm nice about it. Let's talk to Johnny.
Remember
about
I said about teachers teaching too much and talking too much? She was a
teacher. Well, I think it's only fair to give
kidding.
The consequences.
No, I agree.
The first day.
Instructors, I want all instructors to be themselves. And if that works for them, I definitely want them to use it. If something else works for you, then use it, okay?
Mm-hmm.
I like just showing the kids exactly what, by just using an example, okay? And then sometimes I'll pull that first kid that I did it to. At the end of the class, I'll give a little something special. Or I'll pat him on the back and say, you didn't really do anything bad. I was just and he'll be beaming, you know. No, I didn't, you know, I'm okay, you know. He likes me, okay?
Yeah.
And it works just fine, okay? Behind that is as a roll sheet. I mean, do we just put this in here as an example? This is what you're going to see tomorrow when we go to our first after school program. It's got a lot of information on here. You keep these with you at all times. It's got the names of the children. I want you just to look through it on your own. It's got all the contact numbers you need to find. So when you're going out with the kids after class, you have this roll sheet with you. Why? Because you might need those numbers to call the parents. You always have your cell phone with you as well.
Mm-hmm.
You have, does that child get picked up? If so, by whom? If they don't get picked up, you'll see a Y in the daycare because that's where they go to the aftercare program. Okay, so it tells you who's teaching the class, what school you're at, what the location is. On the bottom of all roll sheets, very important, tells you who you're teaching with, okay? And maybe where they're teaching. It tells you who you're teaching with, what their phone number is. Why? Because if you're late to a program, you got a flat tire, you're sick, we know things happen, you go into action, you call your lead instructor, say, you're gonna be late, or, you know, so that lead instructor is gonna answer that phone, they know what to do as well. They're gonna come over to your class, pick up your kids, take them to their class. Those kids need to be supervised until you show up. Or you need to call the office and say, look, I'm going to be late, I'm sick, or my car, you know, I got in traffic, I got an accident, or something like that. That's the responsibility that we talk about in the interview as well. We need responsible instructors, okay? We have a very high reputation in this district for always being a quality program. Never leave our kids unattended. We'll go through that a little bit later, too. In the back of every the back of every folder in every kit, you're going to see this. And what this is an incident report. And then also instructions for how to fill out the incident report, okay? This is very important because should we ever have an incident in class where a child gets hurt, we need to do the right things, okay? And this tells you what to do. So you want to read through this beforehand and have a look at this. This needs to be filled out and sent immediately to our office. What we do is review it, figure out what happened, and send it immediately up to the legal department, the mad science group. They want to see what happened.
Mm-hmm.
You know, does our insurance cover this? What we need to do? We always call our parents, make sure the kids are okay. You're probably thinking, how many times do we use this? We've used it three or four times, I think, in 10 years. So not very often at all. And no child has ever been hurt with us, seriously. We did have one child that that actually passed out. They just got a lifesaver. Our instructor got the lifesaver
out. They didn't pass out. The kid passed out on me in a camp because he hadn't drank enough water that day. He's like, I feel funny. And I went to him and I caught him. As he passed out. But the lifesaver got choked, and we told Mad Science, by the way, we should take lifesavers out of
there. Yeah, and interesting, you know, lifesaver, and almost was a life ender.
Right.
Okay, so anyway, so it was a taste test, and what the kids do, they were blindfolded and holding their nose, and they're supposed to tell by putting the lifesaver on the tip of their tongue.
They're drawing their tongue, right? Their
something they dry their tongue off and taste it.
Well, the idea,
or it's just a blind taste test.
That's another thing that we do. Yeah. We dry the tongue. We do it in the camp, actually. The idea is just to try to figure out what color the lifesaver is without the sense of smell and sight, which are key integral parts of taste that we don't figure into it, come into play. And the kid decided he was going to swallow the lifesaver instead of just taste it, and he choked on it. It was a little kindergarten or something. So what we do now, so Mad Science was really good about it. They took it and they ran with it immediately. They called every Mad Science in the world, all 200 of them, and said, stop what you're doing in this program immediately.
We're going to use Kool-Aid powder now.
Yeah, and we told them, we're going to use Kool-Aid powder. So now what you dip a popsicle stick, you wet it, dip a little Kool-Aid powder, put it on the tip of your tongue so you're tasting different colors of Kool-Aid. So it works better. But they were really good about it. Okay, so we're done on this side of the folder. This side is some stuff you don't have to do. It's more optional. You always have optional stuff. And it's just some articles. You know, is America flunking science? It's a good read. It's about, yes, the answer is yes. Still is flunking science. This is a bit dated. It's about 6 years old now. It was the cover. It was a Time cover article.
Especially little girls, too. Girls are still, women in general, are underrepresented in science.
Yes, we're always trying to work with groups of girls. Girls Inc., when we can. I love working with girls. Girl Scouts, Brownies, all those organizations.
Oh, cool.
Our science score is slipping in this area. This is a little bit dated, too. Yes. It's funny, they were slipping for a while. They leveled off, actually went up a little bit, and now they're dropping back down again.
Mm.
Okay. America's Failure in Science Education. This is a Newsweek article. Same thing, kind of before. It just talks about kind of our failure as far as advanced industrialized countries in the world, how far behind we're falling. And there's some interesting statistics out there these days about how foreigners would come to the U.S. because we have the science education in the world, get trained in our universities, and then stay here and work in this country and help find, found companies and work in startups and things like that. But now there's a difference. In the last 10 years, these people are getting their training, their education here. They're not staying here. They're leaving, and they're going back to India, and they're going back to China and Asia, and they're starting companies back there.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a big brain drain going on right now. And hopefully we could help stop some of that, or our role a little way. What we do, that's what you're going to see next.
It's a pretty large one.
Yeah, it's a large one, and again, it's an optional read. Why I have this in here, you can go to our website and even better get more updated versions. This is all the programs that we do. And why I have this in here, because as an instructor, you're out in front and you're working with the kids and you're working with the parents and you're working with the teachers and you're working with the principals. We're back here in the office supporting you. So we want you to know what we do. So when a parent stops you and says, hey, this is the greatest day ever, he goes, do you guys do parties or something like that? And instead of saying, well, I don't know. I have no idea. We want you to know what we do. So yeah, we do great parties, my kid has a scouting event coming up. Do you guys do anything like that? And instead of saying, I don't know. Yeah, we do great scouting events. We do big events for small hands-on programs for dens, and we do big events for entire packs, And we do after school program, or we do PTA meetings, and we do exploration programs for entire schools and entire grades. And we do FCAP programs that help kids, fifth grades, improve their ability to do their score on the FCAT and raise achievement scores. We do all kinds of stuff. And we do corporate events and we do preschool programs. So we just want instructors to know what we do because you're going to get questions all the time about, hey, this is great. What else do you do? Or do you do, I've got a four-year-old at home. Do you do anything with that? Yeah, we've got a bunch of preschool programs. Give us a call. Let us know where your preschool's at and we'll talk to you about all the different workshops
that we do. Do you guys have cards that you
get to do? Lisa, can you get some cards? I don't know how many we've got. We've got to get new ones made pretty soon.
We have a lot of promotional materials in the events and the party. There's always flyers, business cards, etc. They're not in all the after-school program kits, though. Maybe they should be.
One of the things to do, what we need to do in the future, is when we get the new cards made, I'm waiting for our dress to change
as
we
move out of here.
We need to get some.
That's okay.
Yeah, well, our dress is probably going to change at some point soon, so don't take all this, because I'm running low myself.
Yeah,
take some, and we'll get more. And the idea is we get them for made for each Mad Scientist. Maybe not their name, but they'll say just Mad Scientist on it. So you can say, hey, call us. Yeah, we do those stuff. We do everything, you know. Anything related to science, we're going to do. So, okay? Mm-hmm. And if we don't do it, we can come up with a program that'll pretty much suffice. So we just want instructors to know what we do, because you're our front line out there. You're representing us in everything that we do. Okay, you're going to get more questions than we will in here.
Our phone number is always on the take-home cards. So in every kid, we've got a take-home card, and I say, hey, give us a call. Our number's right here on this thing that you're taking home with you.
Or you can say, I don't know if we do that or not, but I'll get back to you about that.
We probably do.
Okay? And you can, what you do is relay that into us. I got a parent that's interested in this, and he's Johnny so-and-so's father. We'll look them up on the roll sheet. We'll give them an email. And this is how we get things started. We turn, every program can turn into other programs. You know, birthday parties turn into after-school programs, because we send something home and says, hey, you know, if Johnny really liked our birthday party, would he like doing Mad Science after school once a week? And parents will go, yeah, I don't know if you guys did that. Well, let me send you some material, and you can take that into school, because I hate selling things at schools. They're not going to buy things from me, but they're going to listen to their parents.
Oh, yeah.
This is how I first started doing after-school programs. They would take things into their school. I would follow up with a phone call a week later. Yeah, our parent told us about this program, you know, and the parent's pushing the program. And for you know, we've got another after-school program started. So it helped you. Exactly. All right, so that's a lot just about what we do, and we want you to know what we do. Instructor background checks, that's what we're on now. This is a document that tells you about our background check process. If there is something in your background, I always ask this question. We should ask it during the interview. That's going to get caught on a background check. We need to know so you don't waste your money, okay? And, you know, that's fine. But it costs about $85. Mm-hmm. Our policy is you're going to pay for that initially. You're going to get the check. It's your background check. It's your card. Once you get it, you're good for 5 years in any school district and any other job you want to do. So we're going to pay for it, though, at the end of the semester. We want our instructors to stick around.
At the end of the 6 weeks.
At the end of the semester, not the 6 weeks. So
I just spoke in the interview.
I think she did series. We do end of the semester, which is
two
there's
series.
One 6 week series, there's another 6 week series.
Got it.
If you're teaching classes at the end of that series, the end of both series, the end of the semester, at the end of the semester, you put it on your timesheet, we're going to give you this, and we're going to give you what's called your training bonus, which is basically your training. We're going to pay you $50 for training, going through what you're doing today, as well as you missed our training night, which is our big 4-hour program in the evening, but you're going to be doing more, so you're going to be doing a little bit more training with your videos and your stuff at home and everything, and maybe some walkthroughs that we'll do with you here. So that's a $50 charge. You get that, and you get this, so 50 plus 86. You're going to get that at the end of the semester as a bonus if you stick around that semester. We had instructors come through here just to get their background check paid for, unfortunately, and so we had to stop paying for it initially. Or they'll taught one class, as I did, or they looked at one class, like, this is the one that on the day we paid, we were out $100 for a background check. So I said, you do it, it's yours, you're paying for it, we'll bonus it back to you at the end of the semester if you stick around just one semester.
It's kind of nice because it just gives my Edible Peace Patch will love that, honestly.
Yeah, you can use that for that. This is our instructor review checklist for the Mad Science instructor certification. These are probably short.
This is probably not updated, by the way. I think there's 30 items now.
Yeah. Well, we'll give you another one, but there's one more item on here. The idea is when you first start teaching on your own, you're going to observe, and then you're going to teach, we're going to observe. And then after doing your videos and looking through your kid and figuring out that and asking any questions you might have, then you're going to start teaching on your own. Within 5 to 8 classes, when you think you're ready, or you tell us to come in, or we'll say, hey, Kelly, we're going to come in and do our instructor review with you, and you're going to say, fine, or I'm not ready, I want you to come in tomorrow, or something, whatever you want. Yeah. Come in, we're just going to sit with you, and we're going to go through this checklist. This is stuff you all know. This is stuff we go through in training. This is stuff that's in your policy manual. One, this is kind of a check to make sure you read our policy manual. You're teaching classes the way we want them to be taught. So you're going to do, there's nothing technical in here. It's all basic kid management issues. So when we get this list checked off, we get 25 of the 30, I think it was. 24, 20, that's 25 of 30 now.
Yeah, 25 out of 30.
You earn what's called your Mad Scientist certification, and you get go from our training wage, which is $25 per program, up to $30 per program. And then raises go up from there every semester. So the idea is if you don't get them all checked off, it's no big deal. You're not going to be fired or anything. We'll just do it the next class, or maybe take a class, do it in a couple more classes or something. But it's all the things that we look for, you know. Are you seeing the kids in organized groups? Is the instructor arrive on time? You know, these are all things that we've trained you on, basically, that are pretty, you know, nonsensical things anyway, so.
What's that?
And then, excuse me, I've got a cold I'm fighting with. And then last but not least is our timesheet template. We're starting to move to Google Docs for a lot of different things. Okay. Your policy manual is going to be sent to you on Google Docs. A lot of documents are going to be sent to you on Google Docs. Our timesheets are done on Google Docs. There's the instructions for it, and there's an example of how to fill one out. You're just filling out. There's certain fields that are calculated for you, so you don't have to fill them out. You know, the amount of mileage that you're going to be paid for certain programs if you drive over 35 miles in a day. All you got to do is enter the number of miles you're driving. You just do that through Google Maps or MapQuest or something. Your role in a particular school, what you did at that school.
So I input this?
Yeah, you're going to input these. And again, it's all on the instructions there. You know, you're at this program, you were an instructor, you were at Perkins Elementary, and you did an after school program at $25. So you put your rate down there. Or you did an event, or you did a workshop, or you did a camp or something. So, and again, it's all these, if you don't understand anything on here, you ask, okay, and talk to us, and we'll guide you through it. It's pretty straightforward.
Is this weekly? I create one of these?
It's every 2 weeks.
Every 2 weeks, okay.
We have a time period. That'll end this Sunday. We usually send out a reminder on Sunday night or Monday morning saying timesheets are due. You can just put it down on your calendar every 2 weeks. Timesheets are due by Tuesday, and then we pay on payday. Payroll is done on Wednesday. What we tend to do is just keep, if you want a hand, you know, check, we'll put it in your with your kid exchange on Fridays. Or if you do automatic deposit, which we always recommend, you can do that, and we just put it right in your bank. It goes right in on Wednesday or Thursday, typically.
Lisa will need a voided check.
Yeah.
I can give her one of those today.
Okay. Yeah, that'd be fine. She can set that up pretty quickly. What's really important here is to name your timesheet correctly. Okay, and their naming convention is listed on the instructors. Kelly, what's your last name?
Harper.
Harper. So yours would be simply Kelly, underscore or space H, and then the last date of the time period. What's today? The 16th, 17th? Let's say Sunday's the 20th.
The 15th.
It would be Kelly, space H, and then, you know, 2/20/2015. Pretty simple. The idea is when you save it that way, we save it and everything sorts correctly. So if we ever get audited or something by our group or the IRS or something, we can say, here's Kelly's all timesheets. They all sort, they all group together and they all sort correctly. So we just ask you to just follow that naming convention. Make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. So we're done with our orientation folder.
Okay.
Again, stuff we want you to read through. Read it through on your own time. Unfortunately, you don't have a whole lot of time before you can start it. But you can read through that this week. The policy manual is what you're going to get on... have you already seen the policy manual, by the way? Or?
I don't know if Lisa sent that.
Yeah.
She shared all of our documents with you or just videos?
Just video.
Okay, so she'll share the timesheet.
But
and...
I'm thinking... I don't even know if I got an email from Lisa.
Oh, I thought you got
because I got an email from you that talked about Lisa, and you sent the video.
Well, we'll send you video links to all the programs, so at any program ever, you have access to this video training. And the policy manual is electronic on Google Drive, and the timesheet, and the directions for the timesheet. So
all that'll be on there.
Today.
The policy manual needs to be read through cover to cover. It's going to answer a lot of questions. There's a section in your policy manual about each individual type of business that we do, type of program, after school programs, in class workshops, special events, birthday parties, camps. You're going to read through the section first about after school programs. That's going to tell you exactly kind of what to expect when you show up that first day. It's going to talk a lot about first days because first days are a little more important, a little bit different than the normal days because we're first getting our kids, we're organizing them, we're taking roll, we're getting name tags on them, we're looking for lost children. So there's all the little procedures in there that just happen the first day of a program.
Okay.
So definitely read through that so when you get there, you kind of know what to expect a little bit. You're not going to be doing it. We'll be doing it. You're just more going to be observing, participating. But just read through that section in particular. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through. I kind of have an outline here. You signed your forms. Did you get your independent contractor form?
Yeah.
Hey, Lisa. Yeah. Sir, can you grab those?
Mm-hmm.
They talked probably in the interview about you're an independent contractor here in Florida. Best way to work. So there's a form you just need to sign. And then also what's called our non-compete form, which is because you have all our knowledge, our proprietary knowledge, our videos, our manuals, our kits, or everything, that you can't quit and become your own mad scientist for 2 years after you leave here.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a legal requirement by our parent organization every instructor has to go through. I have a 10-year non-compete, I think, because I'm the owner of the business. So that is the independent contractor agreement. Since we're on video here, why don't we say that you can do this afterwards? All you got to do is sign there. I'm sorry, print there, sign there, and date there. And then...
Here's a sample.
Yeah. we'll come in with, we'll show you the other doc. If you have the other document as well, I can show her what to do.
How come we don't just put this in the orientation folder?
That's what I used to do. For some reason, it doesn't happen anymore. I used to have it sitting right there because it was always the first thing they did.
Let's just put blank one in.
Yeah.
Is that the
That's another blank
unstapled
folder.
Version? No, that's the stapled.
That is the staple. That's the unstapled.
This is the...
That's the unstapled.
Did you make this
one? That's hers.
Oh, where's the... Okay, I'll put it in the thing. The thing.
Okay, all right, went through everything, employee contact list. You saw that. Is her name already on there?
I added the employee contact list.
It was a spreadsheet. It was a spreadsheet we had somewhere in there.
Yeah, Lisa said it's not going to be a regular part of the folder, but we'll just put it on the agenda so we remember to
remember
give it.
Remember the spreadsheet we handed? Or?
I put it in. This one is the one I made for her, and I put it in there. I thought.
No,
I
this
don't
is
know.
The one I've been going through.
Yeah, I know, but I made that for her.
I just made this
Friday. No, you didn't. You made this one this morning.
Oh, God. Okay.
I made that one, which probably is the one that has the... It used to have it in it. Where did it go?
I just saw one.
But anyway, we have an instructor contact list that I printed. And it's
it just gives...
Is this it right here?
Yeah, there it is.
Yeah, so that's something... what you always want to do is in your car, you keep a folder. And in the folder, I always recommend this. You can do it any way you want, however you best get organized. And in that folder, you have your roll sheets with you, so you don't lose them every week. Always take your roll sheets out of your kit or whatever you got, put it back in your folder because you're going to need them week to week. You have this, and that gives all our contact numbers for any instructor on there. On your roll sheet, on any program that you're teaching, you're going to see the contact numbers for the other instructors that are at that location. So you can call them if you need to. That's part of our procedures as well. You want to read through that in your policy manual. But that's just a contact list for everyone. You can kind of see how to get a hold of everyone we have. You notice that there's a different north, kind of a Hillsborough office and a north.
Mm-hmm.
Kelly is part of our group down here, correct?
Yes.
So you're in our main group right here in South County. okay, policy manual. I just talked about a little bit of that. Read cover to cover as soon as you can. Okay. Focusing on that after-school program section because that's where you're going to be. We're going to be looking at tomorrow. So I always recommend it's always better to read through things before you see them, so you know what to expect and you just kind of see them in action. Oh yeah, this is what I read about. You know. Dress code. We always have a dress code in Mad Science. You wear your. Have you seen our lab coat?
Yes.
Okay. You're gonna have a lab coat. We'll give you one today, probably. Hey, you guys, does Kelly have a lab coat yet?
I will, no.
Okay, we'll get you one. Closed-toed shoes. We are mad scientists. I just don't want people wearing flip-flops. Doesn't look professional. Your lab coat, we want it clean, which means like any other piece of clothing you have, just throw it in the wash, okay? We have people showing up sometimes with filthy lab coats. It's just wash them, you know? It's like in any uniform, we want to keep it clean. Later on, we have this summer, if you're sticking around with us, for sure we have t-shirts and hats. Sometimes we have polos that we give out. But as the summertime, as it gets warmer, well, instructors can do t-shirts for camps and things like that. Hats, I'm not sure if they make the hats anymore, but when they come out with hats, we'll give hats out, something like that. Excuse me, I'm going to blow my nose real quick.
All right, so we will issue you a lab coat, and we track it. And also, it is advisable to buy a luggage cart. We have a few you can purchase from us, and if you return it in good condition, we give you the money back. It's $25 deposit for a luggage cart, or you can buy your own for about $25 at Walmart. So we'll do that today. So I'm thinking I'll get a couple sizes for you to try out.
Okay.
Several times.
That's a good question. There's someone's room. I think about 10-ish.
Yeah, you know.
Keep on today. Somewhere. Okay, dress code, we talked about that. Proper care and maintenance of kits, very important. Our philosophy with that, as with everything that we do, is treat people the way you want to be treated. That goes with your kids, with your parents, with your teachers, anyone. It goes with our other instructors, and it's very true. The idea is when you give a kit to somebody else, and it exchanges the way you want to receive a kit. Do you want a dirty kit? Do you want one that's completely disorganized or stuff's missing from it? No, you want one that's clean, it's organized, everything's in where it's supposed to be. If we look through, this is a sample kit. They come in two different sizes. They come in this size, and they come in a little bigger tote, which is probably about 40% bigger than that. This is Lights, Color, Action, which is not one of the kits that we're going to be using here in our Natural Wonders program. We're doing this actually up north. you can see that everything is in bags. This bag actually is in it. So this is, and typically in a bag, you're going to find different sets of bags. Like I said, we work within groups. All our kids are in groups. They're in five different groups. So you'll typically see five different bags within a larger bag. And that means that bag goes to the group. And so when the group leaders come up, they get their bag, they take it back to their group.
So we do group leaders?
Yeah, we'll talk about that in a minute. You're going to need group leaders for everything. Flashlights. So let's look for the folders in here. So here's our folders. You typically have a folder with all kinds of laminates in it. This has a lot of, because it talks about the electromagnetic spectrum and Roy G. Biv, you know, about light spectrum and things like that. Here is the folder. In the folder, you might find things about equipment. You're going to find our ever-important equipment maintenance log, okay? This is a log that needs to be filled out every time you use a kit. What it is, you just put your name on it. You take when you checked it out, when you check it back in again, okay? If anything was missing in the kit, if so, if the answer is yes, you write in the box what was missing. Was everything working or was it not working? If something was broken, write yes, put it in there. So when this kit comes back, instead of having to look through the entire kit, and what we do is we look at the maintenance log, which you've filled out because you've used the kit. And we can say, okay, looks like there were some plies that was missing, there's not enough airplane, or not enough 3D glasses, so we had to use those, or here's another one, was anything not working? Yes, their flashlight wasn't working. So now we know, we need to go check the flashlight, get new batteries in it or something, or get a new flashlight in there if it wasn't working. So this helps immensely. If you don't fill them out, we're going to miss stuff in the kit, and the next instructor is going to get the kit. That flashlight's still not going to be working. Why? Because we don't know it's not working. This tells us it's not working. What we love to do, in addition to this being filled out, is to text or call Sarah, our equipment manager, before you even get to the office. Why? Because if she knows the flashlight's not working, if she knows there's not enough toilet paper, if she knows that there's a bag that's broken in there, that she can have everything ready before you come. So when you come on an exchange, if you're coming on Friday right at 5 o'clock or 5:30, she'll have everything ready to go for you. The new flashlight, the batteries, everything that's broken there for you, not for you, but for the next instructor, basically. Instead of even having to look through the kit. So you can tell her, hey, Sarah, you know, here's what's wrong with my kit, just to let you know, or text her or whatever. So it even helps that way. Otherwise, when it comes back, we're looking through the maintenance log, getting it quickly, and out it goes to the next instructor. So very important. You have to fill these out. If you don't fill them out, we're going to warn you and say, Kel, you didn't fill out your maintenance log. You get $10 for every equipment exchange that you do. If you don't fill them out, we're going to warn you, and then we're going to start docking that bonus. Because why? Because then we have to spend all the time going through the kit, particularly if it's messy. If your kits are messy, we're going to warn you, and then we dock the bonus for the exchange because we have to spend all the time cleaning out the kit or reorganizing or fixing stuff that's not in the maintenance log or it's messy in the kit. So we just want you to, and if the kit is messy when you get it and we didn't catch it, put it in a maintenance slot. This kit was a mess, you know, or this thing was unorganized, you know, and I took the time to do it. So we want to know, one, there's other reasons for this too. If something key is missing, we can track back the instructors to find out where exactly it was missing from, what classroom it was in. We can go back to that school, that classroom, ask the teacher. The teacher will tell me, oh, yeah, it's sitting in the corner of the room. It's been left here for 3 weeks.
Yeah.
But we know exactly the history of this kid, so we know where to go looking for stuff. We're missing stuff all the time, unfortunately. Okay, so maintenance log in the middle. Oh, and look, here is our... it's in reporting procedures, okay? You'll find that in the folder, in this folder, in this pocket of this folder, in every kit. So you have a blank there if you need it, okay? And you have the instructions to follow. We always have blanks and the instructions to follow. Anything else would be in here, which is little pieces of equipment that have directions. We'll make copies and put them in here. Try not to lose anything.
Mm-hmm.
This is for the drill, which I don't even know if we use the drill in here anymore, do we?
I don't know.
It used to be for the color wheel.
Yeah.
You know, it was really cool because they would color spin the color wheel and you see different colors and things. So that's our maintenance slide. I should have held it up, sorry. And then our manuals is here. Excuse me. And we seem to have two cheat sheets in here. And they look a little different, Sarah.
Excellent. Sometimes there's a cheat sheet for a booth.
So you might want to take a quick look at that.
This is a station cheat sheet. So
oh,
highlighted,
it's
highlighted. It says station cheat sheet. This is for 15 to 30 minutes of content.
Yeah, it's a booth, basically.
And then this is a full hour.
Yeah. So what we do is we take the cheat sheet and you put it right in your manual there. I would take this and put it in here just out of the way. Because when you're teaching your class, when you're training for your class, this is what you're going to read. And this tells you everything about the class that you need to know, but it's not how we teach the class. This is how we teach the class. If we make any changes to that, they're on here. Okay? The last thing you want to do in a class is you want to be reading your manual. Hey, kids, light is really
28 pages
cool.
of text.
A prism bends light. We use the word refract instead of bend. You're going to lose the kids in a second, okay, mm-hmm. if you start doing this. So, yes, we want you to read the manual. It tells you the science behind things. It gives you script. It gives you a lot of cool points. It gives you concept emphasis. You know, if you're teaching K to 2 kids, these are the concepts you want to emphasize. If you're teaching age 3 to 6 kids, or grades 3 to 6, mm-hmm. that's the concept you want to emphasize. So again, it's that age level thing again. Okay, everything in our programs are usually divided into one of three things. A discussion, which I talked about, very short. Usually you start off with a discussion, the rules, introduce what you're doing, lights in this case, you're introducing the concept of light, color, okay, and then you quickly get into either demonstrations or activities. This is where we're doing the science. Demonstrations are something that you're doing as the instructor with the kids watching, but we call them interactive demonstrations. So whenever you do a demonstration, try to make it interactive. That means you bring the kids up, one or two children, or the whole class if you can, as a volunteer or assistant. This is where you can use those reward mechanisms again. Who's behaving here? I'm going to pick you to be my special assistant for this experiment. So they're going to help you with your experiment. Even if they're just standing there doing nothing, they're still going to be completely owned about being up there because they're a part of what's going on. So that's what I tend to do is even on events where they got nothing to do, I still, like Egbert, I still bring them up. They're just happy to be there and to be a part of it.
You can hold the egg for a second,
hold the beaker while you put something in the beaker or something. If you're pouring one thing from another thing in, don't do it. Get the kid to do it for you. Get the child to do it for you. They just love to be a part of it. So interactive demonstrations. The third thing is the activities, and that's the most important thing that we do because that's what the kids are doing. When you go through a manual, you're going to see that everything, see this is an activity, okay? Things start off with typically there's an activity, Newton's color wheel. It also gives times in here. These are kit preparation things that we leave in here. There's your introductory discussion. Let there be light, okay? It is timed for 2 minutes, okay? Pretty quick introductory discussion. Discussions tend to be no longer than 5 minutes max, okay? You don't want to lose the kids. You want to get right into this doing stuff. When kids come into your room, one of the first things they're going to ask you as they kind of filter by you is, what are we going to do today? You know, and that's very key. What are we doing? We're going to do all kinds. I don't tell them.
You'll see.
You're going to do all kinds of stuff. But the key word is doing, okay? That's what because that's why they're there. They know they're going to get to do stuff. Kids will ask all the time, when are we going to get to do something, okay?
Yeah.
And the more involved you keep, the more engaged, the more they're doing, the better they're going to, the easier they're going to be to manage, the better job you're going to do of managing them. Discussion, and then we get right into activity here. Okay, activity.
Sometimes on our cheat sheet, you'll see we've shortened discussions or lengthened activities or changed it around a little bit because we like to do it a different way.
Demonstration here, okay? You can see these are little script, little things to ask the kids. So you read through the manual. It gives you the science of it. It gives you the educational value at the start, what the take-home message is, you know, the key thing we want to get into the kids. Our cheat sheets. These are our manuals. We can't change them, okay? But we do change the programs quite a bit. Some programs we go pretty much by the book. It's almost exactly like the manual. Other programs, almost completely different. We've changed so many things in them that the manual will almost bear no similar semblance at all to the cheat sheet. What we do, sometimes we turn a demonstration into an activity. Sometimes we turn an activity into a demonstration. Sometimes we rearrange the order of activities and demonstrations. Sometimes we'll change the time, the duration of things. We change all kinds of things. Why? Because we want to keep, always improve our programs. This is where you come in as an instructor. If you see an opportunity for something better or a change, something that can improve the class, communicate back to us. This is very key in what we do. We want feedback from you. We want feedback from teachers, from the kids, from the parents. We always want to improve our programs all the time, okay? So the cheat sheet is how we actually teach the program. And it's simpler. What you do is take the cheat sheet, you put it inside your window like that, so you can always refer to it, you know? The cheat sheets are very, we think are very well put together. We try to keep them to no longer than 2 pages max. And what they have what you're doing. If this is a discussion, this is a demonstration, or this is an activity, okay? The name of it, the equipment that you need for that particular activity or demonstration. So what you can do when you put out your stuff, your activities here, your next one here, your next one here. So to me, I just work right down the table. And so I know my cheat sheet is out, my first activity is here, my second demonstration is here, my third activity is here, it's all together. Okay, so instead of being in one big pile or working out of your kit, just work down, sometimes you'll have a round table, you can kind of work around the table clockwise or counterclockwise, but the more organized you have your stuff right in front of you, then you know you're not missing anything, everyone's getting everything they need. So it tells you what needs to be out there. So when you're going through your video and you've got your stuff out, refer to your cheat sheet. Read through it. Okay, I should have this, and I should have, you know, for this Newton's color wheel, it's a demonstration. I need the drill, the color wheel, so the drill's still in there, color and the glowing ball, okay? And those are things you're going to be using. For the spectroscopes, you'll need this, 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 and this. And then on the cheat sheet, it gives any different instructions that are different from the manual, or some key things in here that are key, or key concepts to get across, key vocabulary, cool facts, things that we've added to the manual. So it's good you can kind of read. You can read off your cheat sheet a little bit. We don't recommend ever reading from anything, but you can glance down, see where you're at. It's also key in pacing and timing yourself. Mm-hmm. You'll know that what I always recommend every instructor to do is to maybe write the time on their cheat sheet of, you know, if you start your class at 2:45 and this is 3 minutes, that's going to take you to 2:48, you know? Then this is 3 minutes more, that's going to take you to 2:51. Why? So sometimes you can glance at the clock and see if you're behind or ahead of where you're supposed to be. Then you know if you can slow down a little bit or you need to speed up or you may need to, God forbid, you may need to skip something. Okay? We can't do this on these because a lot of classes start at different times. But I do recommend instructors on their own little sheet or on their own or a copy of a cheat sheet, write the times down sometimes before, at first, and you'll get the hang of it pretty quickly, but sometimes it's good to know to glance at that clock and see, this is where I'm supposed to be at in this particular class at this time, to know if you're behind or ahead of where you're supposed to be. Because casing is key in that build-up technique. You can't build up to something and then have to leave the something out at the end, you know? The slide, you can't leave that out at the end. It's the key thing. It's what everything's building upon. It's the take-home for the kids. You got to leave yourself enough time to do it. And you've got to get your kids out there. Their parents are waiting for them on time. We have a real huge problem with instructors, you know, just keeping their kids in class way longer than they should be. Then parents get upset. They got busy days. They need to get home, get started on dinner, go grocery shopping, pick up another child somewhere else. They can't wait. And they won't sign up for the class if they continually wait out there, even as much as they love it or their child loves it.
Right. So we're wrapping up 5 minutes before the end of the class. And by wrapping up, we're done with the take-home. We're passing out the card and lining up and leaving for Carla.
I got ahead of myself. We're going to talk about that separately. But so I just want to go through the kids. So maintenance logs. cheat sheet. Yeah, yes, for sure.
I think a good time to look at that cheat sheet is when they're doing something.
Right up the stairs through the... Okay, so proper care and maintenance of kits. We kind of went through a kit real briefly, and the folders in it, the cheat sheet. That was probably a minute here. Weekly meetings. These are our equipment exchanges. I'm not sure if Sarah talked about these in the interview. Again, how after-school programs work, you're going to be out teaching classes during the week at the same schools with the same group of kids using the same kit. So the first day, you're not going to know. And, you know, you're going to, for your first time, might be a little nervous. Second time, it's going to get easier. Third time, it's going to get easier. Fourth time, you're probably going to do it without even thinking about it, okay? And then that's it for that kit. And then you're going to come back to the office on Fridays. You're going to exchange your kit, give it to another instructor, and then that instructor is going to get another kit from another instructor. Off you go on your second class, the six-week series. Do the same thing again. Come back on Fridays, exchange your kit. You get paid $10 for that. This is going to happen six times in a row for all six of your classes. We go to spring break. We take that off. We take another week off as a makeup week in case we need to make up any classes. And then we start the same kits again, called the same series, but a whole different set of schools. So on your available days, we'll have you with another schedule, different schools this time, different six-week program, different kits, but the same kits. So you're going to know the kits the second time around. You won't have to spend all that learning curve that I talked about. Okay. So it's going to get a lot easier, a lot quicker. So I always tell new instructors, hang on, it's going to get a lot better. And the idea is, at first, we want these kits to be easy to learn. You're going to have to learn. As you get to know your kids, it's going to get more fun. As you get to know your equipment and your kids, it's going to get to be more fun. It's going to get to be a lot more fun the more longer you stick around, and the easier it's going to get to you for learn things here and the kind of way things operate. So these weekly exchanges, they're very important. You have to be there. Now, you don't have to be there physically. Your kit has to be there. So where do you live at?
On 7th Avenue.
Oh, so you're close.
Really close.
So some instructors do it this way. A lot of instructors do it this way, actually. If they don't want to come in Friday at 5 o'clock, maybe your last class is over on Thursday. Well, you just swing by the office on Thursday, drop your kid off, so your kid is here on Friday, and then you come back after 5 o'clock on Friday or at 5 o'clock on Friday.
Or Saturday.
Or come in Saturday morning if you want. Pick up your kit and off you go. That just means two trips to the office, but then you don't have to be there at a certain time. So again, it's very important. It's not that you have to be here, your kit has to be there. Because another instructor is going to come by, maybe one that lives up in Largo. They only want to make one trip here. They're going to come in here at 5, give us their kit, take their kit, and they might be right after you in the rotation, so they're looking for your kit. So if your kit isn't here, it wrecks havoc throughout our schedule. You know, the last thing we want is an instructor that's came all the way from Clearwater or Largo looking for their kit and it's not here because the other instructor has not showed up in time. So we warn you, and then we start docking those exchange bonuses again. And very important, instructors have to be here with their kids.
My last class, I think, is on 4, ends at 4 on Friday.
Yeah, and does she teach? I don't think she's even teaching on Fridays.
Yeah, you're on Fridays.
Yeah, so you can drop off on Thursdays if you wanted to and do that.
No, I'm on Fridays.
Okay, on Fridays, come on Fridays. Okay.
Yeah, after Friday.
Okay. Yeah, okay, yeah. And it's good. It's good because, one, you'll meet as a new instructor. You didn't go through our training, so you'll start meeting other instructors that are around here on Friday afternoons and stuff. And so you start to get to know them a little bit. Sometimes we have what we call hot exchanges, where if you're out of school, we can do an exchange right at the school sometimes. I don't think we have to do that with you. It's more when people were distant, you know, and another stuff. We have two instructors who live at Clearwater. We had a program at Clearwater on Friday. We just did it right there, okay, and it worked. We'll customize exchanges a little bit. Mostly it's just one big exchange on Friday right at the office. Weekly meetings, be there. Always communicate again to Sarah. We have this equipment maintenance logs. They have to be filled out. It's better to fill them out when you're in the class at the end, then try to remember. Don't try to come in on Friday and then, oh God, what was wrong with my kid? I can't remember.
We just had this situation where someone was filling it out at the lab, but she forgot all the stuff. And there was like the next instructor had this list of 10 things that was missing or not in the kit that she needed.
What I
went through mine.
Yeah, what I do before I even clean up the class, because it's fresh in my mind what was going on. I don't want to do it during class. I got the kids picked up, I back there, I get my pencil up, I write down this was wrong, this was short, this didn't work. So it's right in the maintenance log right then. Then what you want to do, come, you call Sarah. You can call, text her, call her anytime. Basically, right, say, and this is, and it helps.
You know, your off days.
Yeah, yeah, no.
Because she sits around her board all week long.
Yeah, okay, right?
Okay, waiting for your call. But the last thing, she doesn't like, you know, Fridays are Fridays. She doesn't like to have all this stuff come crashing down on her on Friday.
No,
she'd rather much see it on a Thursday night or a Wednesday, where you're trying to say, hey, Sarah, you know, this flashlight doesn't work. You know, I'm going to need new batteries, or it got broke or something. So we can quickly run out and get you another flashlight, or maybe even have to go shopping.
Right.
What we tend to do on Thursdays or Friday mornings for any new equipment that we need. So if we have that information ahead of time through a text, or an email, or a phone call, or something, she just knows about it ahead of time, so we have them waiting for the next instructor, and we don't have to rush through a Friday evening if we have to. All right? Okay.
Go to girl.
Responsibility of children. This is very important. We talked about this earlier, that we never leave our kids alone. When you're typically, we work a lot of programs where the kids are given to us and the kids are taken from us, typically at private schools, and even some charter schools, some art clubs, some YMCAs. But at a typical public school program where parents sign their kids up for this program, we are the sole, take sole responsibility for those kids. In other words, when school ends, they come to our room for mad science. We're taking care of them. We're teaching them science, having fun with them. And then off they go. We get them picked up by their appropriate parent. And then we go back to our class again. So we're their sole care provider. So we have to know that. And we have to be responsible about these kids. So we never leave kids unattended. If you have to go to the bathroom, you just pretty much got to hold it till the end of class, you know. If kids have to go to the bathroom, make sure they go in pairs, you know. Make sure you know where they're going, you know. If the bathroom's right around the corner, make sure you account for them when they come back. The last thing you want is just, you know, kindergartners wandering around the school, you know, unattended. You know, doesn't look good at all. So we want to make sure we collect all our children. You take role is very important. We want to know what kids are missing, what kids are not missing. If a child's not at your class 2 weeks in a row, we want to know about it. Why? We want to call the parent up and find out, hey, you know, what happened to little Cindy? You know, we missed her 2 weeks in a row. Sometimes the parent will say, well, she doesn't like the program anymore. We want to know why she doesn't like the program. Yeah. We want that feedback. You want to know what happened. Did something happen in the program? Maybe she's sick. Maybe she's got the flu or something. At which point, we'll send them a goodie bag at home. We'll send them a nice Mad Science Get Well card. And we'll send her the take-homes that she missed in school. If a parent calls us up anytime and has got the, you know, be proactive about telling us that she's not going to be there, we'll send them the Get Well card, the goodie bag, and the take-home. But if they don't call us, we don't know about it, we'll know through the roll sheet. So if we know they're a couple weeks in a row, we're going to make amends to make sure
they're treated properly. So did you do this at the beginning of the class, or the end of the class?
You always take role at the beginning of the class.
Okay.
Why? Because you want to know if, and then when you're always taking role, all this is going to be in your policy manual that we do as well. When you take role and someone isn't there, you want to do is scan your role sheet, find other kids that are in that child's class, and you'll see they're by grade, it's sorted by grade and by teacher. You're going to ask the other kids in that child's class at school, were they in class today? If they say, yes, he was in class today, a flag goes up immediately.
Although sometimes they are unreliable information.
Sometimes,
we found
yes.
You can't always count on them.
The younger, the more unreliable. But if they say, yeah, he was in class today, but no, he's not in Mad Science, then a flag goes up. And you say, uh-oh, this child must have forgotten to come to Mad Science, okay? At which point you go into your procedures that are written in your policy manual about how to find a lost child, okay? If you have a lead there, it's going to be much easier. The leads are going to come by. You'll tell the lead, here's who's missing from my roll sheet. They'll go find them. But typically it's you there, and you have to know how to find that child. You can call the office. You can send two kids to the office as a parent to look for that child. Or you can, if you don't show up, you actually call the parent when you just get a spare second and say, did you pick up your child today, or did you remember they had Mad Science or something? Yeah, it's pretty easy to find a lost child, actually.
Okay.
Just know that the underlying thing I'm trying to get at is we're responsible for our kids. You got to make sure they're all there, they're all picked up properly, and they're all taken care of during the class. Dismissal car line pickup at schools. When you bring that roll sheet, you have your roll sheet with you at all times. You never leave class without it. When you after class, when you leave class and you're taking your kids in a nice single line together, out at car line, you can't have kids sprinting out ahead like some boys, and some girls are really slow. They'll just take forever to pack up their backpack. My daughter's one of them, okay?
They're organized.
Yeah,
they're very organized,
but they're very slow, okay? And the idea is you got to keep them all together, you know? And nobody leaves this class until everyone is aligned, ready to go, and then we're walking to car line, okay? The parents don't want to see their kids sprinting out to car line there, and there's no one supervising them, so have them together. When you get out to car line, you want to have your cell phone and your roll sheet. Your cell phone has to be charged. It has to be ready to go. Why? Because you have all those phone numbers on there. If a parent's late, how are you going to know who to call and find out where they're at if you don't have your roll sheet with you? The number will be on there. If that parent is late, you have to call that parent, find out where they're at. And we have different procedures for parents being late. If that parent is going to be real late and all your other kids are picked up, well, then you say, well, here's what classroom we're in. You can find us in there. That parent, you make that parent park, walk in your classroom. Why? Because you want to be cleaning up your kid. You don't want to be sitting out there for 20 minutes. And that child's going to be helping you clean up your kid. Okay? You just tell the parent, you come in and collect your child from me in this classroom. They're going to be helping me clean up. Okay? That's fine. Okay? And after a certain period of time, at 15 minutes, they're going to owe you money on top of that. Okay? They might not have it that week, but you tell us, we'll remind them from the office, and they'll come in with it the following week. And how late charges work is they pay it directly to the instructor. We don't want to collect the money. We don't need for it. It all goes to you anyways. And you just have to ask for it. Parents are more than guilty, feeling guilty about being late pickup. They're more than happy to hand you a $10 bill the next time they show up for being late the previous week.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sometimes I'm calling them. If it's 10 minutes, I start calling, just making sure you're coming and you're aware of our late policy.
I always love the story. We had this one parent at Plum Elementary, and I was there the first class. I was kicking off the program, and this girl kind of tugged at me. She goes, my mom is always late. And I said, sure enough, she showed up late. And I said, okay, this is your warning. Next class, it's $10. Well, apparently, I gave the class to another instructor. This instructor kind of liked the class because they made an extra $10 because the mom was always late. She would just pull up with a $10 bill out of her hand like that.
Sweet.
And get him in the car, take the $10, and off they go. You know?
Sweet, yeah.
It was like clockwork. All right, responsibility of kids.
Exactly.
If there's any contact information that's wrong on our sheet, you make sure and correct it, send it to us so we can update it from here.
Sometimes you can turn in your roll sheet with your equipment on Friday if there's any changes, and then we'll print new ones.
Sometimes I hand the phone to the child, and they just dial their mom, where are you? You know, and they hand the child back to me. Hi, this is your meds.
So when do we get our roll sheets? At the beginning of the program?
The lead instructor will bring that in name tags to the first program.
Typically, why? Because we'll email them to you, too, ahead of time, just so you can have a look at your age group of kids, their names and everything, but up to the last minute they are changing. Even after the last minute they're changing because parents are signing up at the last second, even though their deadline was a week ahead of the program start.
This is why sometimes we have to cancel classes. We didn't get our minimum enrollment, or we have to add classes because we got a bunch of kids.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Parents,
we never know exactly.
Tend to sign up no matter how much we promote them not to, and we discount them to sign up ahead of time. They love to sign up at the last minute.
Yep.
Okay? And I live with one of my wife does it all the time. Okay, she signs up everything at the last minute. Okay.
We won't show her this video.
Yeah. Okay, she would watch it anyway.
No.
Training. We do lots of training here. You missed the training night. Okay, that was a good chance to meet the other instructors. No big deal. You're going to meet them eventually anyways. We'll have more training nights. Videos, online training, very important. It's best. What I do is what I used to do. I don't do it anymore because I know everything. Is you sit down with your kid and kids if you got them, or a boyfriend or a husband
cat.
Or wife. Or what's that?
Pet cat,
dog, whatever. Open your kit. Turn the video on. What I do is I just keep pausing the video. Okay, I saw that experiment's done. Let me get out and try it myself. Okay, and then always be thinking, how am I going to do this? Up to 20 kids in my room with me. Okay, is one of the key things to do. The mad science videos, the videos that are our parent organization made, they're good videos, but they don't tell you much in detail about how things are done. So we make our own videos here. There are a few systems like NASA, we still use their videos, they're still pretty good. But we tell you a little bit more detail about how to do it, and plus all the changes that we've made in things, that's where our videos kind of come in handy.
How about tomorrow for the energy web at the beginning of the class, where you take a string and you hand out, you know, to the producer, the consumer? I'm just trying to visualize, are the kids in tables? Are they at individual desks?
Mm-hmm. So the web's going from table group to table group to table group.
You're gonna seat your kids in groups. We're actually gonna go through.
That's exactly gonna like think about how this
is gonna work. And so each group is gonna get a card, and then you're gonna throw that string from group to group to group.
I almost wish our videos could have real children in them, but we don't have 22 children to like use for videos all the time.
Oh right, and you have to get them all to sign a release form.
Yeah. Oh exactly. We try not to videotape children.
So again, best way to always do your experiments before class. As much as good as the videos are, and as good as your cheat sheet and your manuals, you can't read that and watch the video and expect to know. And this happens all the time.
Well, all the questions the kids are going to ask too. Well, you have to be kind of prepared as well.
And
or maybe it's not working. Like we've had instructors be like, "Oh yeah, I read the stuff and watched the video," but then they go to do it.
Here's what
and
you
they
need
can't
to
do it.
Here's what you need to practice what we preach, and it's all about doing. By doing the experiments in your kit, you're already going to have done them, so you know how they work. Mm-hmm. Little nuances,
like put on those glasses, light a sparkler.
Just do everything, okay? And also, when you're doing the experiment, you're double checking that everything is in that kit that's supposed to be in there. You'll find that if you're short on anything, that unintentionally it wasn't put on the maintenance log or it wasn't called in and we didn't spot on the kit. Okay, this is where you find that. Now, if something was missing, this is key too. We found this out just recently. And if something was missing, what do? You call us. We're going to meet you at that class with anything that's missing. Okay, don't just say, "Well, I'm going to have to try to get through the class without this." We're here to support you. We're going to meet you at the class. The lead can come in with any supplies you're missing. One of us will run over to the school and drop something at the office so you can pick it up. Always know that if something's missing or not in that kit, not right, this is where that communication process comes in. Let us know and we're going to fix it. Again, our job in here is to make life as easy for you as possible. So if those kits are all well put together, the equipment is all in perfect shape, the supplies are all there, you can concentrate on the fun part of this, on the having the fun, managing the kids, and getting the most out of it for them. We don't want you stressing about the equipment at all.
Okay.